I've just been informed that we are going off the air and switching over to the emergency broadcasting system.
Hell is overflowing, and Satan is sending his dead to us. Why? Because you have sex out of wedlock. You kill unborn children. You have men-on-man relations, same-sex marriage. How do you think your God will judge you? Well, friends, now we know. When there is no more room in hell, the dead will walk the earth.
What's up, everybody, and welcome to the Grindhouse Syndicate. I am your host, a mall security guard with a redemption arc, and that is my co-host, a zombie baby. And today, we are covering one of our favorite zombie films and one of the coolest remakes, Zack Snyder's Dawn of the Dead from 2004. You know, this is like our third zombie movie in a row.
Is it?
Yeah, so we had 28 Days Later. And then we had Maniac Cop, which he's a zombie. And then now this movie.
Yeah.
What's going on?
Maniac Cop, I wouldn't consider that a zombie movie. I guess he is like a... That would be the same premise as considering like Jason a zombie movie.
Yeah, but we've just had three movies in a row where there's been like a zombie in it.
Yeah, but I don't know. Maniac Cop, he's like killing people. He's
so like, were the zombies.
But zombies don't like dress in their police uniform and hide from the cops. Like, he's still somewhat
sophisticated zombie.
Yeah. Yeah, but still, I don't count that as a zombie movie.
It's still weird, though, that we did that, like, all three in a row. Man, I remember this movie being, like, such a huge deal for teenage me. Like, I wasn't super familiar with zombie films at that time. I didn't get into, like, Night of the Living Dead or, like, the OG Dawn of the Dead until I was, like, a little older. I think I had only ever seen Return of the Living Dead 2 before this, so that was really all I was really familiar with. And I remember seeing this movie and being like, man, this is, like, one of the greatest things I've ever seen. It's a big deal.
I was a whole 10 years old when this came out.
Wow.
And I don't remember it coming out. I didn't track movies as much then. I guess I did some, like big time, like Friday the 13th. I remember when Freddy vs. Jason came out, that being a huge deal. But I do remember watching this for the first time, and this remained as one of my favorite horror movies throughout my whole life.
The reason that I remember it coming out is because I don't remember what I was watching or what it was, but they had like the first, the whole intro of the movie played. And I want to say it was the whole thing with the hospital and then her going home and then the kid zombie and then like her escaping from, I think it played all the way up until the Johnny Cash song played. And that was like their big promotion for it. It wasn't just like a 3-minute trailer. Like they did this a couple different times. And I remember being like, holy shit, that looks like a good movie. And then I never seen it at the theaters. I don't remember what happened. But then I seen it as soon as it came out on DVD and was like, wow, this is a lot. There's a lot happening here.
Yeah. I'm super excited to do this movie. This is gonna just come out and say it. This is my favorite zombie movie of all time. It's a banger.
It's a good one. But first, if you want to stay up to date on what is going on with us or the show, talk about or submit your movie request, or just say hey, you can always find us at one of our social media accounts or our official website at grindhousehorrorpod.com. Facebook at the Grindhouse Syndicate Horror Podcast, Instagram at grindhousesyndicate.horror.pod, and many more, which you can find links for in the show notes as always. And please subscribe or follow for alerts on new episodes. And if you really love us and don't want us to have to live in a mall because hell got full and the dead are now walking the earth, give us a review. Dawn of the Dead is a 2004 action horror film directed by Zack Snyder in his directorial debut and written by James Gunn. It is a remake of George A. Romero's 1978 film of the same name. It stars Sarah Polley, Ving Rhames, Jake Weber, Mekhi Phifer, Ty Burrell, and Michael Kelly. The story is set in Milwaukee and follows a group of survivors who take refuge in an upscale suburban shopping mall during a zombie apocalypse.
Man, imagine your first movie that you get to direct, and it's Dawn of the Dead.
Yeah, he did commercials, actually, before this.
Yeah, this is a big step up from commercials.
And the commercial of the WRX, which is the exact car I have,
yeah,
that was a commercial he did.
Huh.
Yep, that's why he put it in there. So it's
he must have really liked that commercial. It was a cool commercial. Getting that.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. After purchasing the rights from Richard P. Rubenstein, who produced the original, producers Eric Newman and Mark Abraham developed the film more as a re-envisioning of the original Dawn of the Dead, aiming to reinvigorate the zombie genre for modern audiences. Filming took place from June 9th to September 6th of 2003 on location in Toronto, Ontario, Canada, in an actual shopping mall that was slated for demolition. The special makeup effects for the film were created by David Leroy Anderson, who did AFX Studios. It was released on March 19, 2004 by Universal Pictures, where it took the number one spot opening weekend with a $26.1 million. It had a budget of $26 million and a total box office of $102.3 million.
That's good.
You know who it took the number one spot from?
I have no idea.
Passion of the Christ.
Yeah, okay.
reviewers were generally favorable, citing improvements over the original in terms of acting, production values, and scares, while finding it lacking in character development, excessively gory, and indifferent to Romero's preoccupation with consumerism. Many have called Dawn of the Dead Snyder's best film. A spiritual successor, Army of the Dead, was released on May 14th, 2021. Not as good. Definitely not as good.
No.
So the mall where the film was shot was called Thornhill Square Shopping Mall, located in Toronto. It was approximately 45,000 square feet, which is 1 acre. The production named it the Crossroads Mall. The crew completely redid the mall over an 8-week period, adding an expensive water feature near the entrance, 14 stores, a parking structure, and warehouse areas.
I was going to ask about that because you mentioned that it was filmed in a mall that was set to be demolished. And I was like, damn, that was a really nice mall for them to be demolishing. That makes sense. They went in and redid it.
Yeah, they went and redid it. When you see the outside of it, the outside doesn't look bad. They didn't do a bunch of stuff to that.
It just didn't look old.
No, it didn't look too terrible. It wasn't in terrible shape. I don't know why they were redoing it.
Did they see how nice they made it? And they're like, we're going to keep the mall.
Nope, the mall's gone now.
Oh, bummer. Yeah.
Since Snyder wanted these stores palpable in terms of design and stood not merely as just storefronts, the team accordingly built them as actual retail stores, complete with merchandise. These stores were given fake names, since only two major retail brands agreed to be featured in the film. I don't remember what the other one was, but the main, what was it?
There's a sports store.
Yeah, those are all fake. The ones that agreed to be in the movie, they end up not using any of them. and it was Panasonic. Panasonic was like the only one that was cool with using it. And I know that they wanted to do the coffee shop, Starbucks, and Starbucks said, fuck no. So they named it the Hollow Grounds.
Well, Starbucks, your fucking coffee's overrated anyway.
The special makeup effects for the film were created by David Leroy Anderson with assistance from his wife, Heather Langenkamp. Since the filmmakers had decided that the zombies in the film would become more decomposed over time, Anderson accordingly researched on the appearance of decay following human death. Looking through several medical books, war footages, and crime scene photographs showing graphic images of trauma victims in order to properly depict this appearance. So yeah, it's really cool. Heather Langenkamp did a lot of special effects makeup work in this movie.
I did not know that she assisted in that.
Yeah.
I do know that he made it a point to show the decomp of the zombies throughout the movie. I thought that was really, really awesome. Really well done. I thought that whole team, and it was probably a pretty massive team of special effects artists, but they fucking killed it in this movie.
Yeah, so with the mall, the movie was primarily ran out of the mall. Matter of fact, the bedroom shots of like Anna and her bedroom, like her whole house, that was actually also in the mall. The makeup area where they did all the zombies, also in the mall. So they used this mall for everything. Like this was the base for this movie. They didn't take this and go film it different places or do the makeup different places. It was all went down at this mall.
Yeah, that's genius. If you're renting out a mall that's going to be demolished to film in, I mean, most malls have roofs big enough to, if you need to build an entire stage set of a house inside of it, it'd be no issue.
Yeah, so the movie was shot like three different places. It was shot in a neighborhood in Thornhill, which is the neighborhood you see her like driving through, all those humongous brick houses.
Yeah, beautiful brick houses.
I love brick houses. And then it was shot at the mall, and then there was the last minute shooting where they, at the very end where they're doing the boat to the island, that was actually shot on a back lot. So, but that wasn't originally planned to shoot it. So, Roger Ebert gave it a positive review and said that anyone paying to see it is guaranteed to get their money's worth. In 2005, George A. Romero spoke briefly about how dissatisfied he was with the film during an interview with actor Simon Pegg. Romero said that although the remake could pass for a good action film, he felt it was aimless and more of a video game, for that matter, as well as maintained that he was not terrified of things running at him.
Damn.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, we love you, George, but I think he was a little salty. Just gonna put that out there.
So the ratings, Rotten Tom gave it a 76%. That's pretty good. That's pretty good for a horror movie.
Yeah, yeah, for Rotten Tomatoes.
IMDb gave it a 7.3 out of 10. Letterboxd gave it a 3.4 out of 5. And the Google average audience review is a 4.3 out of 5.
Yeah, that's pretty good. That average audience review, I think, is... seems like the most accurate out of the movies that we've covered. Some of the other ones can be hit or miss. Normally Rotten Tomatoes is way off, unless it's a very artsy movie.
Well, I was expecting Rotten Tomatoes to give us like a 30%, maybe a 40%.
Yeah, I agree with that.
And if you would like to watch this movie, you can currently find it available to stream on Netflix, which is surprising because Netflix has a lot of shitty horror movies. And you can rent it on Amazon, Apple, YouTube, Google, and Vudu.
Is Netflix the only time we've ever brought them up as a place you could watch a movie that we're covering?
No, they did the Sleep in the Woods movie.
Oh, yeah, well, that was it. Found that movie on Netflix.
That was it.
So
they have a terrible horror selection.
They used to not. Man, no, Netflix used to find good shit on Netflix all the time.
Yeah, they really dropped the ball with the horror. All right, so you ready to jump into this plot?
Yeah, let's do it.
So we start off at a hospital where we meet one of our main characters, Anna. Anna is a nurse who is reaching the end of her shift when her and a doctor discuss an odd injury of a man that came into the hospital. Soon after, Anna's shift ends and she heads home. And while we are like kind of like following her around, we are getting these really small kind of hints that something strange is starting to happen. Anna arrives home, briefly speaks to her 10-year-old neighbor, and then greets her husband in the bedroom. They decide to partake in some shower sex, and while that is going on, we see a car commercial get interrupted by a special news bulletin. The next morning, we see Anna and her husband asleep in bed when their 10-year-old neighbor, Vivian, appears in their bedroom doorway. The husband starts to get up out of bed, believing Vivian must be in some kind of trouble. We then see, when Vivian steps into the light, that the whole bottom half of her face has been torn off. The husband jumps up to help her, and when he turns to yell for Anna to call 911, Vivian bites a chunk out of his neck.
Damn. Looks good. Fucking neighbors.
Before we move on from this Vivian thing, I do want to tell you that they knew that this scene, this little girl was going to be big in Japan. So a lot of the advertisement for the movie was based around her. There is a whole movie poster with her face on the cover. Just her.
They just, what, could they like little girl horror stuff in Japan?
Yeah, so in Japan, like, little kid horror, like little kid being scary is like the thing there, apparently.
So weird.
And it's even a bigger deal if it's like a little white blonde girl is even like scarier. So yeah, that was like a whole, she was like a whole main character over there. And I'm sure they were probably disappointed when they realized she was only in the first 10 minutes of the movie, if that.
Yeah. I will say that judging by their reaction when they wake up and she's in the house, it almost seems like this has happened before. Like,
yeah, she just comes over.
Yeah, I would be a lot more alarmed if a kid from my neighborhood was in. I woke up, and as far as they know, the middle of the night, it's very early in the morning, and there's a neighborhood kid standing in front of my bed. I'd be freaked the fuck out. I also do want to say I love the opening scene that they do in the hospital, showing kind of the beginning of the zombie apocalypse the day before anybody knows what the fuck is going on. I love that they put that in there.
Anna jumps up and throws Vivian down on the hallway, where she looks back at Anna with an animalistic-like stare. And then she jumps up and rushes back towards her. Anna slams and locks the door and attempts to stop the bleeding from her husband's neck. She tries to call 911, but all circuits are busy. We then see in the background that Anna's husband has just gotten back up like nothing has happened. Anna seems confused by this and calls out to him when he suddenly turns and attacks Anna. Anna manages to get away and hides in the bathroom. Her husband then bursts through the door and she escapes to the bathroom window. Next, we see Anna run out to her car, where she spots her neighbor standing in the front yard with a gun. He tells her to stay away or he will shoot her as he walks out into the street and he gets pancaked by an ambulance.
He got fucking blasted.
Why did he walk out into the street?
I don't know.
He's like, I got to tell her to stay away, but I got to get closer because I need her to hear me.
Bro, did you see that fall into the bathtub?
Yeah,
was that the actress that played Anna? Was that a stunt? I mean,
I don't think
they meant for that fall to be that legit. Whoever took that fall, I'm sure, was probably hurting for a while after that.
Yeah, it was rough. I don't know. I didn't see anything about her stunt double. I'm sure she had one because there's a lot of action scenes in this movie, but I don't know. She then looks around at her neighborhood and just sees pure chaos. Houses are on fire, people are attacking other people, and helicopters are in the sky all over the place. She then hears her husband running out of the front door in her direction. She jumps in the car and speeds off where her husband chases her until he spots another random person who has just walked out of their home. That's funny.
That's the zombie ADHD.
Yep, that's exactly what it is. Like, and the other person just you could tell they're just have no idea. They got like their coffee in their hand. Yeah, they have no fucking idea what's going on.
The fuck was that lady doing? She walked outside in like a robe with coffee. Like, there's houses all over the neighborhood on fire. There's sirens going everywhere. And she's just like, this is a good morning to walk out and get the paper and stand here.
As Anna is driving, we hear an emergency automated response being played on the radio. We see it as just mayhem everywhere. We get like overhead shots of her car traveling down the highway. We see this car just like barely miss her and slam straight into a gas station, which creates this huge explosion. A paramedic attempts to carjack her, and she fights him off and tries to drive away, but this causes her to wreck into a tree and knock her unconscious. And now it is time for one of the best intros ever.
Bro, why was that girl naked? Did you notice that?
Yeah.
I've never picked up on that. I guess because it's kind of through the window.
Is there some
zombie sexual assault happening?
There could be. I don't know.
How do you get your clothes ripped off? Like, what was she doing in that bus?
Maybe she...
Was it a Bang Bros video?
Maybe she was already naked.
Yeah, maybe they were shooting a Bang Bus video. That's what it was.
So this intro, it pretty much starts with a quick clip of a government press conference where basically the government says we don't know what the fuck this is. We then hear an upbeat acoustic guitar start playing, and it plays Johnny Cash's When the Man Comes Around, which, if you do not know, it is basically a song about when death shows up, which is a perfect song.
Bro, this montage and music combo, and then the cool effects they do on the names with blood, this is one of the coolest intros in all of horror movies.
Yeah, I got some little bit of info about that later on. Some cool stuff I dug up. And while this song is playing, we are getting quick shots of like real news footage of social unrest and news broadcast. We also start getting these like really quick close-up shots of zombie faces. It's fucking fantastic. So we jump back on over to Anna, who is passed out in the driver's seat of her car. She wakes up, she goes to crawl from the car, and finds a shotgun pointed at her face. And now we are about to meet another one of our main characters, Kenneth. Kenneth is a local police officer, and once Anna proves that she is not infected, they go walking off into the woods together. If I were her, I would be like, we've got to find a shoe store or a dead body or something. Like, I gotta get some shoes.
Yeah.
She spends a solid 10 minutes walking through the woods, walking down concrete with just no shoes, no nothing.
Yeah, I would definitely I'd be trying to get me some shoes from somewhere.
Well, this is the very reason I wear shoes to bed.
This must have been why they went to the mall.
Yeah, we got to go to this mall, man. I know they got some shoes there. But as they walk through a park, they suddenly get shot at, and then we meet a few more of our main characters. We have Michael, Andre, and Luda. I tried to get a sound clip of Ludacris doing that. Luda. Yeah, I was going to play it every time I said her name.
Bro, I feel like Andre may have just wanted to shoot a cop.
Yeah.
Just going to put that out there. I mean, the man doesn't have a drop of blood on him. He's carrying a gun, and he's walking with another person. How do you almost shoot him?
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, they apologize for shooting at them. They thought they were zombies, apparently, but it doesn't really add up.
Yeah, they have
there.
A whole, like, standoff with the guns, too, though.
Yeah, it's weird. But basically, Michael says, don't go that way. We just tried to go that way. And most of our group is now dead. So now we are going to go to the mall, and Kenneth and Anna decide to tag along. So the group is able to break into the mall through the back door and into like a home goods type store. What was the point of throwing the toilet through the window?
I don't, because the director was like, you know what? I've always wanted to throw a toilet through the window, and I can't get the right commercial for it. So now's my chance.
Well, I don't know. I thought maybe I just was not picking up on it because he looks at the crowbar in his hand. And then he throws the toy. And I'm like, well, like, what's wrong with the crowbar? Like, he almost looks at it like, I can't use this. So he throws the toilet through it. And I'm like, well, I don't understand. I feel like I missed something.
He had taken some hits with the crowbar, depending on the glass. I don't know. But if it would have been that good of glass, though, it probably would have broke that toilet, too.
Well, after looking around for a bit, the group decides to split up and make sure the mall is safe and secure. Kenneth stays with the girls at the fountain, while Michael heads to a sports equipment store, and Andre checks the other doors to see if they are locked. Michael finds a respectable janitor zombie, shout out to Jigsaw, hiding in the closet. He gets attacked and stabs the zombie in the head with a croquet mallet handle.
Bro, I remember from the very first time I watched this movie as a kid, the very first time I picked up on this, I said, did he just put a crowbar down for a fucking croquet club?
Yeah.
Mallet, bat, whatever you call it. Is it a croquet club?
I don't know. It's a croquet, what did I put here? Mallet. Just put mallet.
Okay. Yeah, why would anybody who's ever played croquet knows how fucking cheap and light those things are. Why would you put your crowbar down? It makes no sense. A crowbar can even be used for other things other than killing.
Yeah, I don't. I'm gonna go ahead and say it now. Not a fan of Michael. Just gonna put it out there now. I'm probably gonna say some negative shit about him. This is number one.
Yeah.
What the fuck is he thinking?
Yeah, that was stupid.
So meanwhile, back at the fountain, Kenneth and the girls get attacked by a security guard zombie. This guard attempts to bite Luda's arm when Kenneth runs over and grabs him, causing both of them to fall into the fountain. As Kenneth wrestles with the guard in the water, we see Anna pick up the shotgun and shoot the zombie in like the head shoulder area. She doesn't kill him, but she kind of like incapacitates him, I guess.
It makes him like spaz out.
He's, I guess, in this movie, they call him a twitcher. He's just kind of like in the middle of being dead and not dead. He's just like moving around weird.
Maybe when you like destroy some nerves in the spine or something, this happens.
Yeah, I don't know. The group takes off running further into the mall where they all meet up and get in the elevator. After a short ride, the doors open and they are greeted by three mall security guards pointing guns at them. The three guards tell the group to find another place to hide out, that they are not welcome at the mall. Michael responds with, there is no other place. What the fuck do you mean there's no other place? The world has just fallen apart like a couple hours ago. I mean, I'm not saying that they should leave, but I'm saying that's some dumb shit to say.
Yeah, look, CJ's a dick. But I see his point here. If shit just went down and I don't know what's going on, I wouldn't want to let people I didn't know in. I would be worried about that. But at the same time, three security guards are going to have a really hard time taking over the entire mall. Like, the mall is definitely big enough for more than three people. And you're going to have a really hard time holding it down with three people. So you probably need some more people. But I get where he's coming from.
Yeah, I don't really have an issue with what he's saying. I just don't understand Michael's argument of like, there's no other place. Like they've been all over the city. It's been weeks. It's been months. They can't find any good place to settle down.
They've been walking before we even are introduced to them. And the other part of the city they came from was overran with zombies everywhere. I mean, I could see in that situation feeling like, this is the only spot we found that's not fucking infested with zombies. There's no other place. We're either staying here or you're going to shoot us.
I don't know. Maybe I just don't like Michael. And
I
just
think you were just looking
way.
For stuff. I don't really have an opinion on Michael either way. I think, though, you were looking for stuff there. You've been hiking all over the fucking place, probably for hours at this point, and everywhere's covered in zombies trying to eat you, and you found this mall. I would totally be like, nope, there's no other place I'm going right now. Like, I'm staying here. You're going to fucking shoot me or you're going to let me stay.
The group asks to just stay for a little while and then they will be leaving. The guards agree with the condition that the group give up what guns they have. Andre rejects this idea, but Anna gives up the shotgun and the group exits the elevators. So we learn that the three guards are named Bart, Terry, and the leader, CJ. This whole group is like watching the news coverage of basically the world in just pure chaos. And here we get our Tom Savini cameo. He is playing a local police officer who has figured out that in order to kill the zombies, you gotta shoot them in the head.
Thank you, Tom Savini, for figuring that out and putting that out to the world.
CJ is definitely an asshole. He is pretty much bossing everyone around.
CJ's shit-talking is unmatched, though. I give him that. His shit-talking is like 10 out of 10.
Yeah,
the dude's one-liners are like nobody else can match this guy's one-liners.
What he said, drink a tall glass of shut the fuck up. I think that's probably the first time I'd ever heard that, the first time I'd seen this.
I mean, yeah, he has that, but he has a couple spots in this movie that's just like, damn, he's an asshole, but that was good.
Yeah, so he's pretty much bossing everyone around, and he believes that America is going to figure this problem out. He's one of those guys that's just like really patriotic to the point where sometimes it doesn't even make sense. Like, oh, you know, America's got, the whole rest of the world's going to be fucked, but America's shorted out because, you know, guns.
This guy is the senior security guard of the mall. Out of the three people, he's obviously been there, the one been there the longest. He's in charge of the other two. He thinks being a senior security guard is going to give him the right to run shit and like call the shots. Like, bro, you don't own the fucking mall. You just worked here as a security guard.
He's the president of the mall. We also see in the bathroom that Andre is fixing up a bite wound on Luda's arm. And Anna finally gets some shoes. Michael talks to CJ about securing the mall entrances and painting a sign on the roof so help will arrive. While on the roof, they notice hundreds of zombies surrounding the mall. They also discover that there is a man on top of the gun store roof across the street.
Old Andy. Andy is like the... We hear like, what, two or three lines from him the entire movie? But he's still one of the best characters.
Yeah, he's a character that doesn't really have to have lines, I guess. He's
he's just a good guy.
He's a good dude. And I mean, he can shoot really good.
Yeah.
And he's kind of sarcastic on his little whiteboard. So, yeah, he's likable.
Bro, if this movie happened, we'll get to this spot in the plot. But all I could think about is, man, if this happened now and they had drones, none of this would have been an issue. Think about finding the best drone that's in a mall.
Yeah.
Probably really good. Could just flew shit over to them.
This movie makes me really miss like early 2000s malls when they were like this. But yeah, so this guy, his name is Andy, and he begins to communicate with them using a whiteboard and binoculars. The group also notices a military helicopter flying above them and ignoring their calls for help.
I don't know why they're surprised that this helicopter didn't, like, come pick them up. Like, you gotta think, this is, what, in the first couple days, if not the first day still? And there is a I guess this was the second day, because the first day they got there, they stayed the night. This is, like, their second day there, and... You think with the entire city crumbling and you know how many rooftops probably have people on them trying to wave that helicopter down?
Many.
I would have been sure, like, many. That helicopter's definitely not going to be stopping for us.
Well, there's also, too, I've been in many helicopters and they base a lot of stuff off weight. You can't just stop and pick up 15 people.
Well, another part of the weight, you know, that I was thinking of is, would they even land that helicopter on the roof? Because of how heavy the helicopter is, the roof might not be able to support the weight of an entire helicopter in one spot.
Yeah, I mean, I guess you could hover it like right above the roof and people could climb up on it. But I mean, when you're doing military stuff, you can't necessarily just stop and, you know, go pick people up.
Yeah, they're probably, if they tried to stop and pick everybody up that was trying to wave that helicopter down, they wouldn't get very far.
So later that night, CJ locks the group into like a home decor or home furniture like store because he doesn't want anyone to steal shit during the night. I don't know, where are they going to go with it?
Like, this guy is the best security guard.
Yeah, they're going to get a cure for the zombie apocalypse, and then the mall owners are going to come in and be like, looks like everything's here. And he's going to say, yeah, I didn't let anybody steal anything. And they're going to be like, promotion.
Yeah.
I mean, what does he think is going to happen in his head?
I don't know. It's like he thinks like this shit's going to be over tomorrow. And even everything better be accounted for.
And even if they stole something, they can't leave. You just tried to make them leave and they still wouldn't leave. So where would they go with it?
I don't know. CJ, I feel like that was just his excuse for wanting them locked up. This dude clearly wants to run shit really bad. And this was his way of making sure that nobody else can do anything and take over.
So this sparks an argument between members of this group. And we realize that Michael, Andre, and Kenneth don't really like each other all that much. And Kenneth drops a bomb on the group, telling them that he isn't staying. He plans on leaving to go find his brother at Fort Pastor. The next morning, the group wakes up and sees that there is no more news broadcast anywhere on TV. While Terry is in the guard office, he sees a box truck driving wildly in the mall's parking lot. The guards and the group meet on the roof, and CJ is pissed they left the store that he locked them in. The group wants to help the people in the truck, but CJ says, fuck no. He has no plans of letting anyone else in the mall. They argue about it, and CJ pulls his gun on Anna. Terry is on the group's side and tries to convince CJ, but CJ tells him that he will shoot him too if it comes to that. Michael punches Bart and takes his gun, while Kenneth and Andre hit CJ and take his gun. Terry sides with Anna's group, and the remaining two guards are locked in the mall's holding cell. The group then guides the box truck into a loading dock, where the truck's survivors safely make it into the mall. And we have a lot of people to introduce here.
You know, I don't blame CJ for not wanting to let an entire box truck of people in here. What he says to them, of why he doesn't want to let them in, is precisely what actually ends up happening. He's like, we're going to let the wrong people in, and then they're going to go after us, and we're going to end up dying. And he was right. Two of the people that they let in are about to be zombies.
Yeah. We have Glenn, who is an organ player at a church. We have rich asshole Steve. We have old trucker lady Norma, teenage girl Nicole and her dad Frank, a country guy named Tucker, attractive blonde Monica, and a very overweight, sickly woman who is being pushed around in a wheelbarrow with a bite on her arm and has no name. Anna immediately begins to tend to the wounded, which consists of the wheelbarrow lady, Tucker, who cut his ankle, and Frank, who has been bitten. Kenneth decides to take the box truck and leave for Fort Pastor when the new group explains to him that Fort Pastor has been completely overrun. He asks how sure they are of this, and they say 100% because they just came from there. And Michael then tries to convince Kenneth to stay. Yeah, I don't think Michael was, even though Kenneth does stay, I don't think it was Michael. I think it was actually Andy. Like, because remember, Kenneth basically says, like, fuck y'all to Michael. And he goes up to the roof and he starts talking to Andy back and forth on the whiteboard. And I think that's really kind of, you know, I don't know. I don't necessarily think it was. I think what Michael said made an impact, but I don't think that Kenneth really cares that much about this group like that.
Yeah, I don't think he really cares for him. I don't think he disliked them necessarily.
No, I'm not saying he dislikes them. He just, Michael is trying to kind of be like, hey, you know, these people need you. And I don't think Kenneth really cares about that.
I thought the fuck y'all was a little unneeded, even if you don't like the group you're with. But I get where he's coming from. He's trying to get to his brother. These people that I just met would be the least of my concerns if I'm trying to get to my family.
So while Anna is helping Frank's bite, the wheelbarrow lady dies from her wound. Anna places a blanket over her body and is asking if anyone knows her name. While this is happening, we see in the background the lady suddenly rise back up. We then see her open her eyes to reveal what I would refer to as zombie eyes. They got some cool looking, kind of like silvery looking eyes.
Yeah, the zombie eyes in this movie are cool. I like to think of myself as, I feel like I keep a pretty calm head under situations. But if this fucking lady started running at me as a zombie, I would have absolutely fucking probably had a heart attack and died before she got to me.
She's a very scary zombie.
I would have 100%. Known the moment they wheeled her fucking ass in, though, I would have known that there's something wrong with her. Like, she already looks like a fucking zombie before she turns.
Yeah, you can almost kind of see her veins, you know, like the dark veins in her face.
You can, yeah. I'd have been like, this fucking lady is already halfway a zombie. Like, we gotta wheelbarrow her fucking ass out the door.
So she slowly turns her head and lets out a scream and leaps up after Anna. She chases Anna across the room at record speed for someone that size. Anna grabs a fire poker, turns, and sticks it right through the zombie lady's eyes, killing her.
I would have had a lot more respect for Anna after pulling that one off with that running at you.
So, for people that don't know, they could not find an actress that was this large that could do...
That this, could run.
That could do this, these moves.
That could run. That's all she does is run.
So they actually had to get a guy and put him in a fat suit and dress him up as this. So, and it's really hard to tell. Like, you can't tell that that's what that is. Like, they did a phenomenal job on the makeup there, but
they did. I remember hearing or finding that out years ago. Probably 6 or 7 years ago, and I had to go back and rewatch it because I'd seen it so many times, and I'm like, there's no fucking way that's a guy in there. Like, you can't tell at all. They fucking killed it with this.
So Anna meets the others a little later on and tells them that she believes it is the bites from the zombies that are causing the healthy people to turn. This worries the rest of the group, and Michael decides they need to kill Frank before he turns and attacks someone. Michael is not killing anybody. Like, he's way too, like, a soft dude for that.
Bro, Michael is really, really quick to grab that gun.
And yeah,
based off of just what Anna said.
Yeah, and he's not like that. Like, there's no other part of his character that's like, I'm just going to go shoot this guy right now.
It's like, I got to save Anna.
That's one thing I don't like. He's just one of those, like, one of those dudes, man. He's just one of those dudes.
He's the guy who gets friend-zoned in real life. Yeah, man, I just thought it was kind of creepy how quick he is to grab that gun to go kill this guy. I'm like, you know, I would have came to the same conclusion, but I would have been like, okay, we need to quarantine these people off until they turn. Lock them up. As soon as they die, take them out. But he's like, he literally snatches the gun up and goes to shoot him. Immediately.
So Anna protests this idea and they both quickly head in Frank's direction. Anna runs to tell Frank that basically because of the bite, Michael's coming to kill him. She snitches him out quick as fuck.
Yeah, I always thought this was weird. Like, the dialogue in this was weird.
This seems weird.
Michael's coming to kill you.
And then she's like, do it, Michael. Do it. And then she's like, what about Tucker?
Yeah, poor Tucker.
And Tucker's like, hey, I didn't get bit.
Yeah.
She's like, well, you can't be sure. You should kill him too, Michael.
I don't know. Don't tell Michael that right now. Michael might be like, you're right. Anna said we should kill him. Let's kill him.
Yeah, but of course, Michael can't bring himself to do it, so they decide to let Frank have some time with his daughter, say goodbye, and then Kenneth, which makes a whole lot more sense, will sit with him until he turns. We see Frank die and then hear him reanimate right before Kenneth shoots him with a shotgun.
Well, why did you shoot this guy with a shotgun? You know the mess that would have fucking made? Why didn't you just shoot him with a pistol? Shoot him in the head?
I don't know. This whole scene is like, it's so weird that this whole thing became this argument, because it seems like this right here, what they did, is the very obvious solution for this.
Yeah, I assume they didn't grow up in a world where zombies were a thing. We've seen so many zombie movies and shit, now we know. Like, oh yeah, we gotta kill them. But I guess if we didn't know anything, because you remember, this is all just based off of what Anna has seen. This is her theory.
Exactly.
That's why I said it was really weird that Michael jumped to grab the gun so quick, because if I'm in this situation and I don't know anything and Anna tells me that, I would be like, that's a pretty good theory. Not, oh yeah, that's 100% right, to the point of let's go kill people.
Yeah, you know, that's what I'm saying. I'm like, I'm agreeing with that with, okay, well, let's just see what happens when he dies. Like, look, first let's see if it kills him. Then let's see if he turns. And if he turns, then, you know, we can shoot him.
Yeah, that's why I said I agree with Michael. I wouldn't have been that quick, though. I would have been like, we're probably going to have to kill these people. Let's quarantine them and see what happens.
So next up, we get a montage of what everyone has been up to since settling down in the mall. And it is set to the sweet sound of lounge/swing rendition of Get Down With the Sickness by our man Richard Cheese.
Richard Cheese really fucking killed it on this one.
And we see that Kenneth is still wearing his cop uniform, but has become pretty good buddies with Andy, the gun store guy from across the street. Monica and Steve have been recording themselves fucking. Glenn likes to try on women's shoes. Terry and Nicole have kinda, like, I don't know, started dating or whatever. Anna and Michael spend time together watching movies. CJ and Bart are still locked in the holding cell. Tucker likes to ride bikes around the mall. And Steve hits golf balls into the crowds of hundreds of zombies. I don't play golf, but I would do that too. And I can't, same. I can't even tell you why that's interesting to me, but I would be like, yeah, let's fucking hit some golf balls out there and hit some zombies with them. Let's do it.
Yeah, I would 100% be on the roof with everybody. Even, like, not even the golf balls, just, like, them picking out people in the crowd. Celebrity lookalike.
Yeah, like, zombie jail,
no. What a fun thing to do.
So later on, the group is all having a nice dinner, hanging out, talking. Michael is over there soft-guying it up when suddenly the power shuts off. And at the same time this is going on, we also see that Andre is in a separate part of the mall with Luda going into labor. And she is definitely turning into a zombie.
How did they not all get concerned? Like, when Anna is like, wants to go check on her, and Andre's like, nah, it's all right, she's fine. Like, Anna's a nurse. You would think if your wife is pregnant and about to give birth, you would want a nurse in there, like, to make sure... she's not a doctor, but she's better than just a random guy. The fact that he's, like, hiding her from everybody, and obviously this takes place over a certain amount of time. They kind of do a montage and skip forward a little bit. I feel like some people would have figured this out. Been like, hey, where the fuck is Luda?
So this is actually one of the very few complaints I have about the movie, is why the fuck does it take her so long to turn into a zombie?
Because they wanted a zombie baby in the movie. I've already thought about that. And I'm like, it's got to be so they could have a zombie baby scene in the movie. Because who doesn't want to see a fucking zombie baby?
Well, this movie answered a question that a lot of people's had with zombies is... what if a pregnant woman gets bit by a zombie? Is the baby going to be a zombie too? And what's that going to be like?
It's gotta
and
be.
It fucking answered it. I'm not upset. I've seen a lot of people bitch about the zombie baby being in the movie, about it being dumb. I'm not one of them.
Yeah, I don't.
Zombie Baby, I'm fucking cool with it. I'm 100% excited about Zombie Baby.
Yeah, I'm down with the Zombie Baby. I love that they put it in here. I thought that Zombie Baby looked fucking awesome. But yeah, I feel like that's almost common sense. Like if somebody has a sickness, if they're infected with something in their blood and the baby is feeding off nutrients from the mother, then the baby would come out as a zombie. Just like people with like HIV and AIDS that have babies, the babies are born with it.
Well, I know one of the biggest questions is like, would the zombie baby tear itself out of its mom? And
I don't think babies are strong enough. Matter of fact, I even questioned if I would have shot the zombie baby. Because the zombie baby doesn't even have teeth to infect anybody with. Like, I would have been like, you think if we kept the zombie baby alive,
would it get bigger?
Would it grow?
Yeah, that's, I thought about that too.
Babies grow really fast comparative to anything else that would be a zombie. It doesn't have teeth yet, so it can't infect anybody. Let's just ride the zombie baby thing out and see what it grows into.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm with that. I'm sure the rest of the group would be like, no, but I'd be like, no, hold on, hear him out. I kind of want to see where the zombie baby thing is going to go.
Just put some of some blood in a bottle, feed it, see if it grows.
And maybe it could be on our side.
you could milk Luda's dead titties.
So Michael goes to get CJ and Bart out of the holding cells so they can show him where the backup generators for the mall are. And right before they head into the parking garage, Kenneth decides that he is going to go with them. This is weird too, because he's like, so you decided you're coming with us? And he said, no, you're coming with me. I've done this before.
Yeah.
I was like, what the fuck does that mean?
I question that too. I'm like, you've turned on a mall generator while fighting zombies in the dark? When did that happen?
What part of this have you done before that's similar?
What does the police department have you doing?
There's some stuff Kenneth says that I'm just like,
I feel like that was a cringy line too. Like, no, you're coming with me.
And then like, there's another scene too, where he's like, I folded a lot of flags for people and told, you know, them their loved ones were dead. And I was like, what kind of fucking job, what kind of life have you had where you've done this so many times?
Like, I don't know. Maybe he was in the special forces or something. Folding a lot of flags.
I mean, even if
he's the flag folder.
Yeah, like even if you, I mean, I don't know.
He's the police department of America's flag folder. Anytime any cop in the whole United States dies, he flies out and pulls the flag.
Yeah, I'm just sitting there thinking, what kind of life has Kenneth had?
And part of that job is turning on generators in the middle of a zombie apocalypse if that happens. He's trained for this.
So while they're in the garage, they start to hear something sneaking around in there. We start to see shadows darting across the screen, and we hear suspenseful music. And then it is revealed to be a dog.
A dog. Bro, this whole scene reminded me how bad flashlights were in the early 2000s.
Or LED.
Well, they have one LED, and it's that, for some reason, that big yellow, like, LED light that everybody had.
Yeah.
And the TC had one, like, it was the big one.
For the storms or whatever.
Yeah.
It's got a radio.
But it was all put out, like, all of, like, 300 lumens, maybe.
Yeah.
It's not very good.
Well, it's also like, it doesn't have direct light. It's just like the whole side of it's just a light. So you can't really shine it at stuff. So yeah. I don't even know why they brought that.
Yeah. Flashlights were bad. They had a whole mall to pick the best flashlights, and this was the best shit they came up with. And you know, they all had to like just strip some store from all their D batteries to run them. Like you had these horrible lights that had like 4 or 6 fucking giant D batteries in them.
Yeah, so everyone lets their guard down when suddenly a zombie with no legs comes monkey barring it from the ceiling and drops down on top of Bart, biting his neck.
Lieutenant Dane. You got space legs.
You got zombie legs. And I said yes, though, because I hate Bart.
Yeah, I hated Bart, too.
Most hated character in the movie.
Oh, you think?
Yeah, I dislike Bart the most.
I'd have
even
to
over
think
Michael.
About that. I fucking hate Steve.
What? I love Steve.
No, I hate Steve. I don't mind his smartassness. It's towards the end whenever he fucks his one job up and almost gets everybody killed.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I definitely don't want to be stranded with him, but...
Yeah. Yeah. I'd love to see Bart die. CJ was an asshole, but at least CJ's like...
Badass.
The one, they give him a super great redemption in this movie. But he's still, like, capable. Bart just talks shit and still sucks at the same time. He can't back his shit talking.
No.
That's a good way to put it.
I feel like he also kind of keeps CJ's balls in his mouth, too. Like, he's that guy.
Yeah, he's trying to get that promotion when the zombie apocalypse ends. Where did the zombie come from, though?
They came, he was monkey barring on the pipes.
Yeah, why?
Like, because he's got no legs. He has no other way to get around.
Really smart zombie figured that out.
Hey, we don't know their intelligence level.
I don't know.
Some may be smarter than others. That's why we need to raid the zombie baby to know. We need to know more.
We do. I'm totally with it. Yeah. Zombie baby should have been raised.
Project Zombie Baby.
They could have decorated the nursery and zombie movie shit. Could have been a whole thing.
And then we see a ton of zombies running around the corner at the group. Bart gets eaten, thank God. And Kenneth, CJ, and Michael make it to the generators, which are in a fenced-off area. The group barricades themselves behind the fence, but quickly gets surrounded by the horde of zombies. Within a matter of minutes, they all run out of ammo, and Michael begins to soak the zombies in gas, setting them ablaze using CJ's lighter. Back at the baby store, we see Luda, who is tied up exorcist style, finally die from her zombie bite. The camera pans down to her pregnant belly, and you can see the baby trying to push its way out. Andre sees this and still thinks there is hope that he can deliver his child. Then suddenly, Luda reanimates. While this is happening, Norma volunteers to go check on Luda because nobody from the group has seen her for some time now. We then see Andre begin to pull his baby out of the zombified Luda as she thrashes around on the bed. Norma shows up to the baby store and enters to the front door. When she heads in, she sees Andre holding a baby in a blanket. Andre tells her it's a girl, and then Norma directs the flashlight at Luda, who is over there doing zombie things. She is stunned to see that Luda is now a zombie, and she immediately pulls her pistol and points it at her. Andre says to her, "You want to kill Luda, you want to kill my family." Norma then puts a bullet in the head of zombie Luda, killing her instantly. Then suddenly, Andre pulls a pistol from his waistband and shoots Norma. He and Norma trade multiple shots back and forth as they both slowly fall. The rest of the group hears the gunshots and comes running. They discover the grisly scene. Norma is barely still alive and manages to tell them that Andre shot her before she succumbs to her injuries.
That's the fucking Wild West cowboy shootout between Andre and Norma. Thought this was kind of a weird scene. Like they even hold their pistols down like it's a Wild West shootout.
It goes on for a long time.
I was okay with that part. There's one thing they did with the cinematography is they slowed certain parts of this movie down. Primarily on kills, and like the scene before this, which was amazing, is the zombies on fire. Like they slow that scene down. So I thought it was cool because we got to see like the slow motion, like the impact, blood splatter. But it was just kind of like really Wild West, like gun at the hip shootout between this old white lady and this younger black fellow.
Yeah. Yeah, it's...
Holding a baby at that.
Yeah, that was my thing. It's like, he's got a baby, but he's, you know, he's letting... He's not even like, here, let me put the baby down before I shoot this bitch. He's like, I'm just going to hold this baby and shoot her.
Just got to take care of that baby. Yeah. Zombie baby.
I don't know really where he thought this was going to go either, because like you're going to. So you've got your wife here. That's obviously you've been keeping as a zombie. And then you've just murdered this other woman. Like, you know, how do you think this is going to play out?
It's not. If I was Norma, I'd have been like, look, we'll let you keep zombie baby. We'll let you raise him. See what happens. But Luda's got to go.
Yeah, she's too capable.
She's fucking pissed right now, too. You got to think, like, as a zombie, did she realize that there was another human zombie coming through her vagina? Like, I would, if I didn't know what was going on, I'd be pretty fucking pissed off zombie, too.
Yeah, I don't know. You know, I don't know if zombies are aware that they're pregnant. Don't know that. If you're a zombie listener, write in and let us know.
Especially a pregnant one. If you've just given birth to a zombie baby, we need to know, were you aware that you were giving birth at the time? And if so, was it a natural birth?
So Anna sees the baby blanket still resting in the arms of a dead Andre. She carefully removes the blanket from the face of the child to reveal a motherfucking zombie baby. Anna then points the gun and cocks it and shoots the baby. She wasn't on board with the idea of keeping it, I guess.
She's so quick to shoot this baby.
She is.
That's kind of fucked up. Like, even if we all as a group said, hey, the baby's got to go, it's a zombie, I would not have been the one to have to shoot a baby. Zombie or not, like, shooting a fucking baby? No. A newborn baby?
She should have been like, here, Michael, since you want to shoot things so bad, here you go. Why don't you go ahead and do it?
They should have taken zombie baby if they decided that they didn't want it. They should have just put it in a blanket and, like, lowered it down.
a zombie family would raise it.
Yeah, lower it down into the crowd of zombies and see what happens.
There's like a zombie couple that can't have kids, and they're like, it's a gift. The whole situation sparks Kenneth to go on a rant about how they are just sitting there waiting to die. And Anna and most of the group agree they don't want to stay at the mall any longer. Steve makes a joke about getting on his boat and sailing to an island as an escape, and the group thinks it's a good idea. I 100% think it's not a good idea.
Yeah, I put that in my notes. And probably a lot of people that have seen this movie probably disagree, but yeah, I'm staying at the fucking mall.
Yeah, I'd be like
we have everything we need here at the mall. Like, even if they do escape and make it to a island out there somewhere with no people, how are you going to feed all these fucking people?
Yeah.
Where are you going to get food and water to support all these? Like, yay, we went through all this shit and we finally made it. There's no zombies on this island, but there's also nothing else on this island. How the fuck are we going to survive?
They do not think this idea through very much at all.
Yeah, come on, Kenneth. Like,
Kenneth's like, yeah, it's a good idea.
To be the smart guy, and you think that's a good idea?
Yeah, like, I don't know, man.
They could have taken some food, obviously, but with that many people, even if you took as much food as you could fit on those buses and somehow were able to transport all of that onto a boat and you had ample time to take all the food, that many people is still going to go through that food very quick.
I don't understand.
And then what?
I don't understand why they want to leave the mall.
I don't either. You have everything you need. Look, the mall, the one downside of the mall, a mall would be great, has everything you need. The one downside is there's too many entrance points to cover. That would be the one really bad side. The good part is you can kind of close off each store to the mall. So you can close off each store's entrance point. If the store has one, you have like the JCPenney's and stuff, you can go in. You could close those off.
Have the cages thing.
Yeah, with the cages. But it would still be really hard to cover all the entrances. Plus, the glass would make me really nervous. Like, Is enough zombies going to start pushing on the glass to break through it? But I'm taking my chances here. You know, maybe a Walmart might be a better place to be because there's not as many ways to get in. But yeah, I'm not leaving this place.
Yeah, I just don't even understand why, because they have this one bad situation that happened, you know, and there's really nothing they can do about it. I mean, the guy fucking hid that his wife got bit and then, like, you know, hit her in a store or whatever. And no one decided to check on her for who knows how long. And then that happened. But no one else is pregnant. So, or you know, no one else has went outside to possibly get bit. So I think that from here on out, you're probably okay. But yeah, I just don't understand why this one bad situation. Maybe I can understand Anna. She just had to shoot a baby. And she's kind of like...
She seemed into shooting a baby, though.
But she's kind of like, I don't really want to stay here anymore. But everyone else is like, no, I kind of want to stay here. I kind of don't want to leave here.
Yeah, they're like, oh, I don't want to die in this mall. I would be like, you know what? I'll stick it out. I'd rather die in this mall in 3 years than die tomorrow trying to get to a fucking boat or die in 2 weeks on an island somewhere and starve to death. We literally have everything we could ever possibly need. And we have the place locked down and secure. Why the fuck would you ever want to leave that? I would go live in a mall now.
So Michael says that they could reinforce some of the mall shuttle buses to escape the mall and drive through the zombie-filled city. A few days later, we see that the group has done a lot of work to the buses, including adding siding, a snowplow front, and barbed wire around the top. Kenneth tells Andy to be prepared to leave in 5 days, but Andy tells him that he is starving to death. Yeah, that's what you have to look forward to when you leave the mall.
Yeah.
Ask Andy if he wants to come over to the mall or if he'd rather just, you know...
Yeah, Andy's like, what the fuck do you mean you're leaving the mall? I've been thinking about how I could get to the mall for like a month now.
Yeah. Kenneth tells the group that they must come up with a plan to get Andy some food before the trip. Oh, and Anna and Michael share a kiss, which is weird because her husband like just died.
Yeah, and Michael learned that girls aren't really impressed with zombie chainsaw slots, apparently.
Yeah, it's so cringy, man. He's like, look at this. And he's like, I designed this chainsaw slot. And she's like, oh, okay.
Yeah, my biggest gripe of this whole movie, as far as like the story and characters, is that Anna never mentions her husband. She doesn't seem that upset that her husband is now dead. And she falls for Michael, like, super quick.
Yeah, so this whole entire story takes place over 29 days.
Yeah, so in the span of less than 29 days, she falls for Michael right after her husband just died and became a zombie. And she never mentions it. Like, no. She don't ever talk about him. She don't ever, like, seem upset about it. That was a big, big plot hole, I feel like. Not plot hole, character hole. A character hole. And you should have seen Luda's character hole.
A lot of blood came out of her character hole.
Yeah, I didn't like that. That never made sense to me.
Yeah,
you forget she even has a husband.
Yep. So Kenneth comes up with a plan to lower Nicole's dog, who she named Chips, into a crowd of zombies because, as we learned from the parking garage situation, zombies don't eat dogs. But they want to lower him down with food and supplies strapped to him and have Andy blow a whistle for Chips to run over there. I feel like there's a lot of error in that plan because you lower the dog down and he may blow the whistle, but dog may be like, I'm just going to go this way. I'm just going to go a complete different way.
I feel like, why would zombies not eat a dog?
Maybe they don't know what it is.
I don't know. They seem to know what some, like.
Maybe zombie dogs eat dogs. Maybe you got to watch out for the zombie dogs. Maybe it's a species thing.
People figured out eating, like the first people that ever existed figured out eating meat. You would think if they were that hungry to eat a living thing, that if you lowered a dog down in front of it, it would, even if they didn't eat it, they would probably tear the dog up.
Yeah, I don't know.
Like, it's like they're oblivious that the dog even exists. It's like they can't see the dog. Maybe dogs are invisible to zombies.
So they do this plan, and it works pretty well. Nicole is freaking out the whole time, but when Andy lets Chips in, he gets bit on the hand by a zombie. And I guess all that time that him and Kenneth were hanging out, Kenneth never mentioned to him that they discovered that the bites are what turns you, because he has no idea.
That would be a lot to write. I guess you could write that.
Don't let the zombies bite you. You'll turn into a zombie.
The thing I hate the most about this scene, other than Andy dying, I really liked Andy. But how does this fucking guy who's so awesome at shooting and has this unlimited ammo in a gun store manage to get fucking bit when a couple zombies got through the door?
Well, he says...
Was he not prepared for this plan? Did they not tell him, like, hey... We're sending this dog over. He had to have known. He opened the fucking door.
He did. He talks about it in the, if you have the DVD, you can watch Andy's side of the story.
I've seen it, and I still don't understand why he couldn't shoot them.
Well, he says, like, he was starving, and he was slow, and he just didn't get the thing closed in time, and one of them bit him. Like, the zombie doesn't get in. It just bites his hand as he's closing the door. So, he said, I wasn't on my game. I'm starving to death.
Yeah, I don't know. I've never been starving to death, so I guess I would just be prepared if I was Andy in this situation, knowing what's at stake, that a zombie might pop through that door. And as soon as a zombie grabbed it and started forcing it back open, I would have been on my gun.
Well, with Chip still inside the gun shop, Nicole decides to steal the truck and go after him. This prompts the group to go through the sewer system to try and get to the gun shop to save Nicole. Once they arrive, they find a zombified Andy trying to get to Nicole, who is hiding in a closet. While trying to return to the mall, the zombies chase after them, killing Tucker. The group isn't able to keep the horde out of the mall and decide they all must board the buses and attempt their escape plan now. So half the group board one bus and the other half board the other. They take off, bursting through the parking garage door and out into the street where there are hundreds of zombies waiting on them. There are so many zombies that the buses are pretty much at a standstill. The group all begin firing their guns and finally pull out a chainsaw and stick it out of the side port that they had cut into the bus and begin sawing the zombies in half, and it's awesome.
Yeah, Anna, you're fucking impressed now, aren't you?
CJ climbs on top of the lead bus and throws a propane tank bomb into the crowd of the undead. It explodes and lets off a massive fireball and shockwave. All of a sudden, the road in front of them is clear, and the buses take off.
Bro, what the fuck was with the fucking the zombie that picks up the propane tank? Like, he is roided out. He is on some zombie roids.
Also, why did a zombie pick a propane tank up?
Yeah, I don't know why he picked it up. That didn't make much sense either. But God, he's like the Hulk zombie. I mean, this guy, I don't know, maybe when you take roids and then you turn into a zombie, you just, like...
Get bigger?
Just become a monster. Like, this guy doesn't look anything like the other zombies. He's like a zombie boss. He's the zombie boss. That's who he is.
That's why he picked the bomb up. He's like, no, I'm the boss. I gotta pick it up.
Yep.
So we see that the city is now just a total wasteland, and as they are navigating their way through trash, bodies, and wrecked cars, Kenneth notices there is a zombie hanging on the back of the bus. Glenn, for some stupid-ass reason, decides to crank up the chainsaw for one fucking zombie. Kenneth then almost misses the turn and makes a hard left, causing Glenn to accidentally cut Monica in half with the chainsaw.
Bro, who the fuck let Glenn hold the chainsaw?
I don't know. He shouldn't be touching anything dangerous. He plays the organ. Just give him an organ.
Yeah, I will say, though, Monica's fucking cut in half or cut down the shoulder shot was great.
Yeah, they built a model version of her. And then inside of the chest cavity of her modeled version, they basically, and they made it reloadable so they could shoot it multiple times, but they just packed it full of blood bags. That's all they did.
Well, it looked great. Now I know how to cut somebody in half and not actually kill somebody.
Well, this causes Kenneth to lose control of the van. It swerves out of control and then flips on its side. We see that Steve has survived the wreck and tries to leave the other survivors behind. As he exits the bus, we see he gets attacked by a zombie.
I hate that we don't get to see Steve die.
You get to see zombie Steve die.
Yeah, it's not the same. I wanted to see Steve die. Why didn't the zombie that attacked him keep eating him? Like, I don't get that.
This is a lunch break.
Yeah.
CJ notices the wreck and the other bus stops and goes back to the wreckage to help. Kenneth and Terry are the only survivors of the wreck, and Anna and CJ help them to the other van. Anna runs into a now zombie Steve. She shoots him and grabs the boat keys while trying to get back in the bus. She is almost bitten until Michael saves her. The bus takes off towards the dock with the horde chasing behind them. They crash the bus into the docks, and all but CJ exits the bus. CJ stays behind to hold them off until he is finally overrun, where he eventually detonates a large propane tank bomb, sacrificing himself to buy the others more time.
How did they know what boat to go to? Like, she was smart enough to get the keys.
It's in my next note.
But how the fuck did they, for one, know where to go, know which boat to pick? And then for two, who the fuck let Kenneth drive after the first accident? He literally almost destroys the entire dock with the bus.
Why didn't CJ get off the bus with everybody else?
Because he wanted to be a hero. He had to have his full redemption arc.
Gotta get the full... He's like, I'm only like half redemption right now. But if I do this, I'll be full redemption. Yeah, I don't know. A lot of weird stuff right here.
I don't know. CJ did die a hero. I'm pretty sure that the amount of zombies that he blew up, they would not have been able to all get on the boat had he not done that.
Well, I'll tell you the amount of zombies he killed. It was 5,000.
Well, that is a lot. I don't know who came up with that number, but...
That is the kill count number for him.
Is that all in that one explosion? Or yeah. Does that count the first explosion where Royd Zombie picks up the first tank?
It just said that the propane...
5,000, that's so many.
The propane explosion from the horde of zombies that chased the van to the dock. So, I mean,
that is a bigger propane tank, but goddamn, 5,000 zombies?
Yeah.
Well, in that case, CJ died the ultimate hero, because they would have all died had 5,000 of them not been killed. You'd think that 5,000 of them died, they could have just stayed there. He just killed every zombie in that county.
Yeah, it's a lot. I didn't go back. After I read that, I wanted to go back and see, like, is that really a crowd of 5,000? I mean, I guess it could be.
I think the first one was, because it's like zombies as far back as you can see when Royd Zombie picks up the propane tank. But that size of a propane tank would not have blown up 5,000 zombies.
No.
The second one would have been quite the explosion, but if it would have been big enough to kill 5,000 zombies, I'm pretty sure it would have killed everybody.
Yeah, including the group trying to get to the boat.
If anybody lived, the boat would have been done too. Because you remember, Kenneth, Mr. Driver's Ed, literally crashes the fucking bus into the dock, so they're right by the boat.
Yeah. Yeah, so the rest of the group used this time to board Steve's boat, which also, you know, I guess Steve named his boat after himself, or he wrote on the back, "This is Steve's boat." But upon boarding, Michael tells Anna that he can't go. He then shows her his bite mark from when he saved her earlier. He tells the group to go on without him, and he will just stay and watch the sunset. Sunrise. Sunrise. Anna protests this.
Yeah, the sunset.
Was it? I thought it was night. I don't fucking know. It's something with the sun.
No, it's daytime. Yeah, and the sun's going down. He's watching the sunset.
It took him all day to drive through the city because it was nighttime when they went to Andy's, and then
it's daylight though when they're at the docks. I don't know. That doesn't make sense. The sun has already rose. It's like full ass fucking daylight. Like it's daylight when Steve first pops out of the wrecked bus and gets killed. It's daylight by that point.
Just starting to get daylight.
Yes, the sun has already rose. What is he like watching the sun and move across the sky? He's like, I want to watch it until it gets directly over top of us.
I don't know. Anna protests this, trying to convince him to still come along. He tells her that he can't and that it's okay. The group sails off as Anna watches Michael enjoy the sun on his face one last time before eventually puts a gun to his head and shoots himself. You find it weird that she just watched him kill himself?
I find it weird. I put it in my notes. I'm like, is Anna still looking at him when he kills himself?
She's staring at him.
I find it weird. He's like, I'm going to stay here and watch the sun rise, although it's already rose. Technically, he's watching the sun set because it's already daylight. So I'm just going to sit here for the next 12 hours and watch the sun move across the sky. And then instead of waiting for them to get further away, because he's not like actively being attacked because CJ killed every zombie in the state. He literally offs himself when they're like 200 yards away.
Yeah, and she's still staring at him. And you see her looking at him and you hear the gunshot. And you're like, she just watched him blow his brains out. That's weird.
She was more upset by Michael not being able to go with them than when her husband, like, that she doesn't mention the entire movie when he dies and becomes a zombie.
Well, then she tells him too when he's like, no, I can't go. And he shows her the bite mark and she's like, well, you can still go. And I'm like, wait, you want to take somebody who's going to turn into a zombie pretty soon on a boat?
Even Kenneth is like, are you sure you want to stay here? I'm like, what are you guys going to do? You guys going to keep him on the boat with you? You going to tie him down? You couldn't save zombie baby, but you're gonna keep zombie Michael?
Yeah, I don't know. That's so weird.
They're gonna just dump him off alive as a zombie or dead alive as a kicking zombie and see if he swims in the middle of the ocean.
The movie then goes to credits and we get some found footage of the boat trip. It seems pretty shitty, as we predicted. The boat engine catches fire, they run out of food, they get lost at one point, but they do eventually find an island. They exit the boat and walk onto the island and are immediately greeted by some kind of, I don't know, they kind of look like tribal zombies.
They went to Jamaica. they were in the fucking water for a long time.
It's like Wisconsin, though. It's like where this takes place, so yeah. They don't have access to the sea.
Yeah.
They were talking originally in the movie, they were talking about the lakes, like the Great Lakes having islands. So they're not even in like the ocean.
Yeah, I don't know, man. I guess they fucked that up. You know what I don't get is they get in the water. The Great Lakes are really big, but this looks like the ocean for sure. And you can see in the distance whenever Michael kills himself and it shows the boat. Out in the distance, you can see an island. Like, really far away, but you can clearly see an island. How do you guys get lost going in a straight fucking line?
Yeah, I don't know. I have no idea.
Would it get dark and then it got daylight? And you're like, oh my God, we lost the island we were going straight towards.
They had Chips and Kenneth driving.
Yeah.
Kenneth
did wreck the boat. And who put a fucking head in a cooler? That was my other question.
Somebody.
Who was like, I'm going to stick this head in a cooler and float it out to sea and see what happens. Instead of a note in a bottle, I'm doing a head in the cooler. This was my brother.
Yeah. Yeah, so it looks like some tribal zombies attacked them, and it does not look like they are able to escape, and they die. That is the end. That's the end of the movie.
Cue the Down with the Sickness, which I thought was the perfect music for the end of this movie.
Yep, that's definitely a great song for that time, and it definitely was a good song to put in this movie.
Back when
it's like a perfect song.
Disturbed made really good music. Before the Sound of Silence, and everything became the Sound of Silence.
So director Zack Snyder personally chose most of the music used in the film. His choices included The Man Comes Around by Johnny Cash and Richard Cheese's cover of Down with the Sickness. Snyder was the only person who thought these songs should be in the film, as most of the producers were against it.
Well,
good call.
They were wrong.
Yep, good call.
Yeah, I'm glad he held his own there. I think they had to, how much cheddar do you think they had to pay Richard Cheese for his song?
Paid him only in cheese. The zombie baby scene was originally going to portray the baby killing the mother. It was altered due to graphic nature. I would have liked to have seen that more.
Yeah.
The baby was supposed to rip out of her, is what I read.
Yeah, that would have been really cool. I think if you're going to do Zombie Baby, you have to have Zombie Baby rip out of the womb.
Yeah.
Maybe Zombie Baby just wasn't strong enough to break the water. He couldn't even get through the placenta.
Well,
cue lightning crashes. they should have had that scene with just lightning crashes.
Richard Cheese does lightning crashes. Why Zombie Baby bursts out of his mother.
Man, I wish we could get that scene. I wish we could get just, they said due to graphic nature, so does that mean they shot it and they were like, holy shit, no, this is rough?
They didn't shoot it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's a cop-out excuse.
Scrapped the idea before they shot it.
No, they should have shot it.
No, the only remnants of it that exist is the baby poking out of the stomach. That's the only thing that they ended up keeping from that idea.
Well, that's a bummer.
Yeah.
I think, like I said, if you're going to do a zombie baby, it's got to rip out of the womb.
When Andy meets his demise, it seems that his head explosion was a CGI effect. A lot of people accuse this of being CGI, but it was not. It was done using a prosthetic head molded after the actor. And this can actually be seen on the director's cut DVD extras.
They should have slowed that down.
Yeah,
because it does look like CGI.
I think they sped it up or something, because that's what makes it look CGI. But
maybe
it is a practical effect.
Didn't look good. If they should have had like Tom Savini in Maniac when his head gets shot with the shotgun, that's what it should have looked like. I agree with a lot of people. I thought that was CGI.
Yeah, I did too for a long time as well.
Yeah, it's and one thing they do a lot, like I mentioned earlier, is they slow down certain shots, and it's almost so little it's almost not noticeable a lot of times. But it's slowed down on special effects scenes, so you get to see stuff better. A lot of the special effects slowed down look really cool, and the fact that they didn't do it in that scene makes me think that it just didn't look good, so they sped it up.
Yeah, I don't know. I didn't really see anything about why they did it really fast like that, and they also cut the camera really quick away. But I also haven't watched the DVD extra stuff on it in a few years, so I remember it being on there though. So Kyle Cooper, who did the amazing title scene, he has also done some other very recognizable title scenes. Pretty much all the American Horror Stories, seasons 1 and 2 of The Walking Dead. He did the Final Destination 5, one of my personal favorites, which was 7, and Home Alone. Thought I'd throw Home Alone in there.
That's weird.
No, I mean, I mostly just included his horror movie ones. He's actually done a lot of title scenes for a lot of different movies, but some of the more known ones that you've seen on shows and movies, you don't realize this guy's the one who did them. Like, especially the American Horror Story ones are always fantastic.
Yeah, I agree.
The Walking Dead, he did seasons 1 and 2, but The Walking Dead, he didn't do the rest of them, but they kind of ripped. They just stayed with that theme.
As they should have.
Yeah. So, there is definitely some stuff that you've seen a million times, didn't realize it was the same guy.
What is his job title? Like, he just does title intros?
He is.
How do you get a job doing just the title intros stuff?
Well, he's a graphic designer. And so he doesn't just do that stuff, but he's gotten such a...
The dude's good.
Yeah,
he's good.
Yeah, he's gotten that reputation, so he gets hired on to do a lot of intros because of that. But
yeah, like I mentioned earlier, I think this is one of the coolest intros there is. I love this intro.
Yeah, it's a mix of real news footage from war and riots and stuff like that. And then it's also some stuff they shot for the movie. And Kyle Cooper claims to have used real human blood in the sequence. So all that like blood that's like splattering, like kind of moving across the screen and their people's names, it's all actual human blood.
Where did he get the human blood from?
What the fuck if I know?
He'd go to the Red Cross and it's like, I know there's people who need blood out there, but I'll slip you some Benjamins for some blood.
Yeah, so I watched an interview with him, and he kind of talked a little bit about this stuff. And he said that originally there was this intro scene wasn't in the movie. And after they had done some test screenings, the studio wanted a quick scene to basically explain to the audience that the whole world had very quickly been ravaged by zombies. They didn't want you to think, well, is it just this area? Or, you know, is it just still spreading? Is it just started? Like, they wanted to explain that the whole world is gone that fast. And so they had him do this. And then they also talked about the very end, the end scene. Test audiences actually did not like the happy ending where they sailed off into the sunset or whatever.
Yeah, I don't like that either.
So they actually had to go back and film the other ending where everyone dies, and the audiences love that ending.
Yeah, that's great. One of the great grim endings in horror.
So ratings and the kill count. The kill count is officially 5,200. I'm not kidding. I just went ahead and I went through that 5,000 and I picked out kind of 17 that I thought was...
No, you got to name all 5,200.
We got Vivian, who was turned into a zombie off-screen. Lewis Clark, who was bitten by a zombified Vivian. Frank, who was turned into a zombie. Bart, who was eaten by a zombie. Luda, who was turned into a zombie. Norma, shot by Andre. Andre, who was shot by Norma. Andy, who was turned into a zombie. Tucker, who was shot by CJ after being mauled by zombies. Monica, who was accidentally cut in half by a chainsaw. Glenn, who, when the truck crashed, his neck was broken. CJ, who was killed in an explosion from a propane tank. Michael, who shot himself. Terry, presumably eaten by zombies. Anna, presumably eaten by zombies. Kenneth, eaten by zombies. Nicole, eaten by zombies. So, yeah. So, favorite kill. You picked it, so you're up.
So we are doing a zombie version of this and a human version because there's so many of the 5,200 kills to choose from. So for my zombie kill, there's a lot of really cool headshots in this, but there's so many I didn't include it because all the zombies, other than explosions, die from headshots. So I went with Michael stabbing the zombie through the head with the broken crochet mallet club.
That's a good one.
You call it.
That's a good one.
That's one of those scenes that they did slow down, and they showed that in slow motion, and it looked really good. I'll say a close second for that would be the wheelbarrow lady zombie getting the fire poker stuck through her face. And then for my human best kill, I went with Monica getting cut in half with the chainsaw on the bus.
Solid.
I don't even know if there's a comparison out of the human kills. There's a couple good ones, but that one, as far as the effects go, by far, in my opinion, the best.
Yeah, my favorite human kill, also Monica. I mean, that's hands down the best human kill in this movie. Zombie, I went with zombies on the side of the bus with the chainsaw. Loved it.
That's a good one.
Loved it. It was fantastic. I mean, it's just zombies getting their legs and their torsos cut in half. It's like three or four of them at one time, and it's just a gore fest. It's fantastic.
Good thing that that zombie with missing its legs wasn't hanging on the side of the bus. What would they have done?
I don't know. They would have missed him. Maybe that's the zombie that hung on the side of the bus that caused fucking Glenn to get the chainsaw. We never really seen if he had legs or not.
Well, it could have been one that they had already cut the legs off of that didn't fall off. Yeah. Good pick, though. I didn't consider the chainsaw zombies.
Well, there's so much in this that it's really hard to say. I mean, I wouldn't say that the chainsaw zombies necessarily are far better than anything else. It's just the one thing that's really stuck out in my mind. But there is a ton of really good zombie kills in this movie.
Yeah, this movie, as far as special effects go, there's a lot. Like, normally most movies have one that just stands out that's way better than the rest. Normally, movies will pick like one or two kills to really go hard with the budget and make it look really good. But as far as the zombie kills goes, there's a ton of really good ones in this.
This movie actually had its budget cut, believe it or not. I mean, even though like it has a huge budget, but they had a bigger budget originally, and they released some other, I can't remember the name of it, I hadn't seen it, but another zombie movie had come out. And it didn't do well, and they ended up cutting this movie's budget, but it doesn't look like it. It looks fantastic.
No, it looks like they spent a shit ton of money on this movie, which they did, but they did it really good.
All right, so rating, you're up.
Oh, boy. So I gave this movie a 4.9. In my opinion, this is the best zombie movie that there is. This is my favorite zombie movie by far. For starters, the pace is amazing. They jump right into the zombies. They save all the character building shit after everything starts going down. I love that they jump straight into things. The special effects were amazing. We just talked about, I think the zombies look and act just like they should in a zombie movie. And I love that they showed the decomposition of the zombies as the movie progresses. If you look at the beginning compared to the end, the zombies look much different. That's probably something a lot of people don't really pay attention to. Story and the setting were great. I thought the acting was good. Thought the score and the track listing, which I just found out they didn't want to put in there, I thought that was great. I loved the kind of overexposed cinematography that they used. There's some outside scenes you can really tell.
Yeah, Michael's shirt during when they shoot at Kenneth is super. It's just way too exposed. Like it's almost blinding.
Yeah, but I thought it was cool that they did that. Gave it a really cool effect. I like that they did some slow-mo shots for certain shots, letting you take in the fantastic special effects they used. I really like how they show in this movie a completely different group of people, like a group of completely different people. and how they get along in the conflicts that arise from that. Like, everybody in this movie has a completely different character, completely different personality. And I think they do a really good job showing a lot of that. My only knock with the characters is how Anna never really seems upset or mentions that her husband dies or just died, and that she falls for, of all people, Michael. But other than that, overall, I'd say this was a near perfect zombie movie and a must watch for any fan of horror.
I gave this movie 5 stars. It's got its problems, and it doesn't deserve a 5-star rating, but it's, most of its problems is in character. There is some problems with the story, but it is kind of trying to work off of a previous story. It is a remake. The setting is fantastic. The characters, but I don't really watch zombie movies for the characters. If I'm going to watch something zombie for characters, I'd watch like The Walking Dead or something, but I don't really care about character building and stuff in a movie that's this action-packed, this much, like, effects and gore, and this kind of setting. I mean, who wouldn't want to see what it was like to live in a mall during an apocalypse? That's a great idea. But basically, this movie's just fun. Like, it doesn't really even have any slow parts. The zombies look phenomenal. It's got tons of kill, tons of gore, great soundtracks, like, and it was a movie that when I seen it just was really a big deal to me, and I don't think I've ever really lost that love for this movie. Like, I look at it now and I can see the flaws in it, or I can see why somebody would complain about this. I mean, shit, we just spent, you know, almost 2 hours pointing out some things that we thought were dumb. But it doesn't matter. It's still a great movie to me. And I don't think that without a movie like this, we would have gotten the zombie stuff that we've gotten since then. Like, this, you know, 28 Days Later did cause movies like this to occur. But then this movie blowing up as big as it was reasons why we got stuff like The Walking Dead and stuff like that later on. And, yeah, I mean, I give it 5 stars. I think it's just a fun-ass movie.
Yeah, I don't think I've ever watched this movie and not had a great time. Like, no matter, I've probably seen this movie, I don't know, 10, 12 times now. And I there's never a time that I watch this that I don't enjoy. It has always been one of those movies that has been one of my go-tos. Like, if I just want to watch a really fun horror movie, this is one that I will pull out.
Yeah, it's a good one. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I've never really heard anybody trash it too hard, so it can't be that hated or anything like that. But I love it. I love it. It's a movie that if I just want to shut my brain off and be entertained, that's this.
You know who did trash it? George Romero.
Yeah, well. Well, once again, we thank you guys for listening. Please give us a follow or like if you enjoy the show. Check out the website. Check out the socials. Tell a friend, a family member, or your favorite guy who sells TVs at Best Buy about the show. We hope to see you next time. Any last words?
Make sure you raise your zombie babies.
Zombie babies.